in the presence of my enemy. I'll raise a hallelujah louder than the unbelief. I'll raise a hallelujah. My weapon is a melody. I'll raise a hallelujah. Heaven comes to fight for me. And I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Everything inside of me, I raise a hallelujah. I will watch the darkness flee. I raise a hallelujah in the middle of the mystery. I raise a hallelujah. Hold on me. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm. Louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, King is alive. In the middle of the storm, louder and louder, you're gonna hear my praises roar. Up from the ashes, hope will arise. Death is defeated, the King is alive. I'm gonna sing in the middle of the storm, louder. Bless the Lord, oh my soul, oh my soul. I worship His holy name and sing like never before. Oh my soul, I worship Your holy name. The sun
worship your holy name. And on that day when my strength is failing, the end draws near and my time has come, still my soul will sing your praise.
Thank you. cry of our heart, the cry of our soul deep within. We want more of you, and there's no place we would rather be than right here in your love, Lord. And I just pray for all of us here that we hear your voice, Lord. Speak to our hearts, speak to our souls, fill us up with your presence, fill us up with your love. May we experience your grace and your joy and all the things that are promised in your word abundantly, Lord. And so we live for you. We live out the story you are writing in our lives. And we just pray for the message that BJ will bring. And we say these things in Jesus Christ's name. Amen.
Okay, that's a good start to things. Like you, I've worn a lot of hats in my day, you know, and one of those was once upon a time I was in the Army. Do we have anybody here that served or is currently serving, have families that served? God bless you. It's Memorial Day. We want to remember you guys because it's a big deal. Only 2% of our nation actually serves, and that's a calling. But my time in the Army was cut a little short. I was in California for a little bit because I was supposed to go to the special training in Georgia. And I get in a fender bender, and I'm a passenger, and I get hurt, so I can't. I'm out of the Army. And this is where God, in his word, he says in Corinthians that he uses the foolish things of this world to confound the wise. And so somewhere God, you know, had decided, well, maybe, you know, you're not going to be a soldier, but I'll use you as a Bible teacher. And that's a little bit of an adventure. You know, I got BJ brought up about the expository Bible teaching. I'm not very good at it, so I just have to go verse by verse by verse. And so one time I'm telling my students that we're going to be covering Mark 17 tomorrow. So you guys go home and read this. We're going to discuss it. Well, the next day comes, and I said, who read the text? All of them are, you know, kind of, yeah, I did. You guys get anything out of it? Yeah, yeah. Well, I know you guys are Bible literate, and here there is no Mark 17. So I thought maybe we had to go topical that day where we had to maybe talk about being forthright or sharing the whole truth about things. We all fall short. None of us get it right. But our sin, where we mess up, when we see somebody else doing it, it looks so much worse on them, does it not? I mean, we tell a lie, we see someone else fib or stretch the truth. Oh my goodness, I can't believe a word they say. They don't have any credibility. We see other people make mistakes, and our human nature is to judge. Look, the most perfect place God ever created was the garden. And Adam said it was her. She said it was a snake. And like Solomon would say, there's nothing new under the sun. We always want to blame someone else and minimize and rationalize what we do. But thankfully, we have a heavenly Father that in Hebrews 12:6, God says that he disciplines whom he loves, that he chastises those he calls his children. That's a blessing. Because sometimes when any of us think we're getting away with something or we're dodging a bullet or, you know, I can't possibly admit to this, that's not a good place to be. When we look throughout Scripture, it's when people are broken, when people are hurting, that we reach out to God. And right now, as a church body, as families, as a nation, we are broken. We need the Lord. And I would encourage us all to look in that direction. I don't know if you guys have ever watched this movie or read this book, but The Wizard of Oz. The Wizard of Oz has this young girl, Dorothy, that has to go to a very far away land to find a man that doesn't have a brain, that doesn't have a heart, and that doesn't have any courage. I don't think Dorothy needed to leave Kansas. I don't think she would need to leave Florida or Lake Wales. The Bible says that we, like I said, that we all fall short, that Romans 3:23, that all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. Isaiah 64:6 reminds us that we are all unclean, that the best righteous acts we can do are filthy rags. The only thing good in any of us is God. Amen. And that's where we need to choose Him. And now we're at communion right now. Communion, the very first communion we ever had, was a celebration of a Jewish holiday called Passover. So Jesus is with His disciples in what we call the upper room, and before they even get to the bread and they get to the wine, Jesus is washing their feet. He's showing them how to be a servant. He's modeling for us what we're supposed to do. Jesus is knowing He's going to die. He's in some dire straits. Bad things are going on. But He's choosing to be a servant. He even washed Judas's feet. But I relate a lot to Peter, because he gets to Peter, and Peter's like, God, don't wash my feet. Don't. And Jesus in John 13 tells Peter that, hey, if I don't wash your feet, you can't be a part of this ministry. And so Peter says what? Do you guys remember? Wash the whole thing, God, not just my feet. Well, sometimes when they're handed out this communion and it's just that little thimble of grape juice, I think, Lord, I need 64 ounces of something a lot stronger. I don't think this little thimble is going to cut it. I am a pro sinner. There's not many things I've been good at, and this one I am a pro. So when we take communion at this time, let's examine our hearts, because we can't change other people. We certainly judge other people. We can't change ourselves. Only God changes us. So this is a time of prayer where we go to our Holy Father and say, Lord, before I take this cup that's Your blood and I drink this cracker that's Your, eat this cracker that's Your body, let's get right with Him as best we can. We're just dirt. We're just sin. But we do have a Heavenly Father that through His death on the cross and resurrection, we can be made right. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank You that You are a God and that You are sovereign and that You have given us even the opportunity to know grace. We thank You for our armed service members. We thank You for all the body that's here that just wants to corporately worship You. As we take communion right now, help us to examine our hearts. Help us to see the blind spots I don't want to see, any of us don't want to see. Help us to not just blame or minimize, but to just come clean before You. We ask this in Your name. Amen. Thank you, guys. Thank you.
want to call your attention to a couple of fast announcements. Today, you're going to be probably seeing a few of our family members leaving a few minutes early. We have the community kitchen today. That's an awesome opportunity to be the hands and feet of Jesus. So when you see people at about the 11:30, 11:45 mark, get up and leave. Don't be insulted. I'm going to do my best not to take it personal. Miss Allison warned me she's not going to break things or scream on the way out. So pray for them, okay? This is an awesome opportunity to love the way Jesus tells us to love. So as they go and do that, they represent the Father. This Tuesday, we're doing the men's Brothers on the Move gathering. There's information at the table, at the welcome desk. If you are interested, open to all the guys that want to come, all right? If we pack out that place, we'll move to a bigger place. So I would love to see you there. Then June the 9th, that's 2 weeks from now, we're going to be having our Join the Move gathering. That's where people interested in becoming a member. You can come and learn about the church. You can come and learn about the history, the legacy, and the direction, and how it works. So anybody interested in that, we invite you guys to sign up. We would love to have you come and hang out. If you came prepared to share a gift, we have offering boxes fastened to the walls as you exit the room. So if you're invited to do that. And then Stephen did mention it, and so did Mr. Carley a moment ago. Today's Memorial Day, or tomorrow's Memorial Day, but today is our chance to appreciate. We remember the sacrifice part of that equation, right? Like, the veterans who have served, we are grateful for, but this is a day where we honor the price that was paid. And I would like to pause a moment and just ask if there's anybody in here whose family has paid that price, would you stand up for us so we can give an appropriate appreciation to you guys? If you have a family member who has passed in the service, look at this. Wow. I know it's one of those you don't want to be spotlighted, but we need to tell you thank you, because your sacrifice in this country, in this service, is giving us even the chance to be here right now. We're blessed and we're grateful, and there's never a sufficient way to say thank you, but we're still going to give it a swing. We love you guys. Thank you. Anybody here ever gone whitewater rafting? All right, we got a handful here. A few years ago, I was a young man. I know that's hard to believe, but in my high school career, I went on a youth trip with my church. They called it adventure camp. And we did some of everything in a 1 week bubble of time. We went rock climbing, we did rappelling, we went spelunking, cave diving. We did high ropes courses, we did low ropes courses, we did everything in 1 week, and probably the highlight for me that week was going whitewater rafting. Went on a Category 4 river. If you've ever gone before, 2 and 3 is normally where you get introduced. You don't start messing with 4 and 5 rapids until you're experienced. But my youth pastor hated us, I guess. I don't know. Or or he loved us. It was that tension in between. We're on one of the coolest rivers I've ever imagined, and the Ocoee River, and it is a thrill. We've mastered the craft. We've been on the raft for a couple hours now. I think the guide tells us that we're about halfway down the river, and it hits this lull. The water slows down a bit, and the raft guide says, "Hey, you two up front," and he pointed to my brother and I. We were at the front because, you know, we were beasts. He says, "Hey, you two, I want you guys to put your oar inside the boat. I want you to climb off of the seats that go in between the raft. I want you to climb off the seat and up to the raft itself, sit on the raft. There's a rope." He said, "I want you to take the rope and stick your leg through it so you're, like, fastened." And he said, "Lay back." And so we're like, what are you trying to do to us? I don't think this is good. And he goes, "You got to trust me. You look like you're in for a thrill. Trust me, try it." And so my brother and I were both quite stupid at that point. Haven't grown out of it, so we do it. We throw the raft, the oar in, and we tie ourselves to the raft, and we lay backwards, and about that time, it hits the category 4. And I'm telling you, the plunges down the waterfall areas, the dipping and diving through the water, the rocks that we were jostling as we hit the trees, it was the coolest thing I've ever done in my life. It was insane to experience that. And the whole time, I'm sitting here going, what if I'd have said no? Like, this was amazing. How did I get so lucky? All the other guys in the raft were sitting there cheering for us, but they didn't get to do what we were doing right then. We were invited to go a little deeper, to get a little crazier, to go a little harder. And today, I want to put that on the back burner for us, because I have been sharing for a few weeks. I believe God is doing that very thing here with us as a church family. The last handful of weeks, I've been sharing with you guys that I wholeheartedly, with everything in me, see that God is offering us a new wine, a new experience, a new invitation, an opportunity to participate in something cool, something crazy, something amazing that we've sampled before, but have we really gone here yet, right? And last week I was able to share, part of that picture is he's creating a new temple. God has always desired to have a place where we, you and I, are fully known, we're fully loved, we're fully valued and connected with God and with each other. And so last week when I mentioned the temple, I'll be honest, like, I didn't think that was my best work, but it was one of those, like, last Sunday for me, it was a crazy Sunday. I won't get into all the details, but I was sharing with you guys, like, God wants to build a new temple. He wants me to be that temple. He wants to invite all of us to let this turn into a place where his name, his presence, his people dwell together. That's a great invitation. So the tabernacle, the temple, I want to submit a cool idea to you. It's a metaphor. It's a picture. It's an illustration of what God wants us to understand in the work that he's doing in us. As we learn to love God, as we learn to love others. You guys know the passage that Jesus speaks in Matthew 22. Religious leader comes to Jesus thinking, I'm gonna trap him now. No way out of this. Teacher, tell us the most important commandment, and let's see how he answers this. And Jesus' answer, Matthew chapter 22, starting in verse 37, in the New Living Translation, it says, Jesus replied, you must love the Lord your God with all your heart, all your soul, and all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. A second is equally important. Love your neighbor as yourself. The entire law and all the demands of the prophets are based on these two commandments. And Jesus didn't get trapped by the question, right? He actually flipped it back around. Now they're walking away looking stupid. And he said the entirety of the Old Testament, of the Old Covenant, of the Scriptures, all of it hinges on that thought, love God and love others. And I wanna propose a crazy idea that maybe we've never quite connected these dots before, that every single area of the temple that God ordained, that God told them how to build, every single area, every single thing, every single experience was significant. It was descriptive, it was deliberate, and it was a picture of how he wants us to function as his people. Jesus said, love God and love others. And the process of learning to love God and love others, that's not an instantaneous event, is it? That's not a comprehensive, conclusive, like, flash of lightning, and all of a sudden I'm like, oh, I do that perfectly now. No, it's a daily choice. It's a continual invitation to both enter and, sadly for us, to exit at different times, different seasons, and for a billion different reasons. We either decide, today I'm going to love God and love others, or we decide, no, I'm not ready to do that. It's a daily choice for for the disciple of Jesus. You guys know the, you know the passage in Matthew also where Jesus says, if any of you wants to be my follower, you must give up your own way. Take up your cross and follow me. If you try to hang on to your life, you'll lose it. But if you give up your life for my sake, you'll save it. And so I want to paint a picture for us today, all right? Somebody going to the temple, especially if you're one of the people who was a priest, every single thing you would do while you're there would have been a deliberate, intentional, strategic, and methodical choice of, I'm going deeper. I'm connecting further. I'm going to be closer to God. It was an invitation to draw closer to God and to the people. So, for the next couple of weeks, I want to take you guys on a tour of the temple. It doesn't stand anymore. It's not there. You can't visit it, so it's going to be a little tricky. But I want to help us correlate what God designed, what he orchestrated. The picture of the temple, the metaphor, is an invitation I think he's still extending to his people. All of us who would become his temple, as the New Testament tells us, the place where his name and his presence can dwell. So I want you guys to peek at the two designs here. You're familiar with the tabernacle and the temple. If you've ever been in church, if you've ever read the Bible, the phrases are familiar. But these two places were intended to allow people a chance to be part of a community where they could dwell and live with God. The covenant that God made to people on Mount Sinai was, if you will obey my commands, I will do what? Somebody holler that out. I will dwell with you. I will be your God and you will be my people. Amen. He offered it, and guess what? He knew 5 minutes later, we were going to self-sabotage that. We were going to self-idolize. We were going to self-centeredly destroy everything and desecrate every relationship we've ever been given, both with God and with each other. It's like God knew if I give them this chance, they're going to ruin it. And so, as soon as he made the opportunity, the promise, the covenant, I'll dwell with you if you obey me, he had to also offer the chance to sacrifice, to substitute, a way to fix what I was going to destroy and what every human would eventually kill. Guys, I hope that you've never made this confusing mistake before. Don't miss this. Sacrifices in the Bible have nothing to do with a bloodlust from God. I know for a fact many in the secular world, I've read philosophers and I've read commentators who have said, no, God's a misogynistic, he's a masochistic, he's a monster, genocidal maniac. I've heard it, I've read it, I've encountered it, I've argued and debated it. That has nothing to do with why the sacrifices were put in place. The reality is this, my sin, you can point the finger right at your own face, okay? My sin will literally kill every relationship I have. It will destroy everything I value and love if you give me enough time. I will ruin the whole thing. I will sink this ship. I'll burn this house. I will kill the people I love if you give me enough time. When God expels Adam and Eve from the Garden of Eden, we think that's a punishment. That was a mercy. That was God's grace saying, sin is now part of the equation. I can't let you live forever with that. Can you fathom what a world would look like if we were all allowed to do whatever we wanted to do, as long as we wanted to do it? No decline in health or age or mental faculty if we could just live forever and do what we wanted? That would be hell on earth. God said, nah. No, I can't let him have that. That was a mercy. We're familiar with the story of Abraham being asked to sacrifice his son Isaac. We've heard sermons on it. We've probably contemplated it. Man, how could God ask that? God didn't ask for his son to be killed. God gave Abraham a chance to recognize and learn he would prefer to give us a substitute. He said, Abraham, go up to the mountain and sacrifice the thing you love the most on this planet. That's what sin does. It will take the thing you love the most, the thing you hold the closest. And Abraham's like, I want to be good. I want to do it right. Okay. And God says, no, stop. I'm going to give you something else instead. I'm going to give you a substitute to pay that price. This is what Paul refers to in 1 Corinthians as the wisdom of God. Let me read a passage from 1 Corinthians chapter 1. His perfect plan is so incredible. Verse 18 of 1 Corinthians 1 says, the message of the cross is foolishness to those who are headed for destruction. But we who are being saved know it's the very power of God. As the scriptures say, I'll destroy the wisdom of the wise and discard the intelligence of the intelligent. So where does this leave the philosophers, the scholars, and the world's brilliant debaters? God has made the wisdom of this world look foolish. Since God, in his wisdom, saw to it that the world would never know him through human wisdom, he's used our foolish preaching to save those who believe. It's foolish to the Jews who ask for signs from heaven, and it's foolish to the Greeks who seek human wisdom. So, when we preach that Christ was crucified, the Jews are offended and the Gentiles say it's all nonsense. But to those called by God to salvation, both Jews and Gentiles, Christ is the power of God and the wisdom of God. This foolish plan of God is wiser than the wisest of human plans. And God's weakness is stronger than the greatest of human strength. That's the perfect plan that God's always had in place. I'm going to give you a substitute so you don't have to die for your sin, but so that you don't have to kill all the stuff you love for your sin as well. Adam and Eve, as soon as they sinned, Mark referenced it. As soon as they sinned, what did they do? They pointed at each other. They pointed at their sin, their shame, their nakedness. And what did God do? He provided a covering, a loving sacrifice so that they, and I think so that we, don't have to be constantly exposed. That's the point of the sacrifices in the Bible, to let us turn the death, the destruction, the rage, the hate onto something else instead of the ones I love. That's the work that Jesus accomplished on the cross. His innocent life is destroyed by my sin instead of me, instead of the ones I love, because nobody would be left alive if he didn't pay that price. We know Romans 6:23, for the wages of sin is death, but the gift of God, the free gift of God, is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. It's death. You earned it. It's coming. Nothing can stop this train. There will be no one left but God. Amen? So the temple, I want to spend a few weeks looking at the temple because it's a metaphor, it's a picture. The very layout of the temple is a picture of how God intends us to go into his presence, to dwell in his community, to experience his love. So when somebody went to the temple, King Solomon's temple, and then later when Herod rebuilt it and restored it, I've got kind of a diagram up here. Well, I'll use this a bit going forward. When they would enter the temple, they would come into the first area of the temple that you would walk into was a place called the court of the Gentiles. It was the outer area of the temple compound. It's the area where outsiders were permitted to hang out. It's where they were able to come and like see in and peek in. It's the place where like the surface level, the superficial relationships with each other and with God, it's where that could happen, that far outside bubble. I'm going to come back to that place in a second. If you continued going to the temple, the next place you would come to would be a place called the court of women. Now, we usually hear something like that and think, oh my gosh, how sexist can they be? It had nothing to do with sexism. It had nothing to do with that. It probably, we would rename it now in our modern 21st century vocabulary. We'd probably call it maybe the court of intimate relationships or intimacy. This is where your family and the people you were really close to could come. This is where your spouse and your closest friends are allowed to dwell and watch and participate in what's happening at the temple. You continued going in further. The next place, you go to a place called the court of the Israelites. And in the book of Genesis, we learned the word Israel was the name God gave to the patriarch Jacob. Jacob meant somebody who wrestles with man. And when he wrestled with God and God called him, he changed his name to Israel. Israel literally means wrestles with God. This is where the people would be confronted with their identity, where they would struggle with God, where they'd have to face the consequences of their failure, their sin, their old nature, our old nature. It's the conflict. You continue going in from there, and you go to a place called the court of the priests. And this is where the sacrifices happen. This is where the blood gets spilled, where the price is paid. That's where you slaughter the animal, where you cleanse yourself afterwards, where the atonement's made. These are really, really intimate and close relationships. Only people allowed there, it's exclusive to, are the priests, the servants of God. You want to go to the next area, and this is really, really rare company, into the temple building itself. The first place you would enter is a place called the holy place. This is literally where heaven and earth begin to intersect. The place where you're not just on the outside looking in, you're in the place now where God's presence is. You have to willfully choose to go in, and you better be qualified, because there's consequences if you're not. If you're not ready, if you're not right with God. This is a place that only the priests can experience, I told you, but it's also where they have several artifacts. One of them was the menorah, the candle. The only light in there was the light from God. The table of the showbread, which represented God's presence, and then the altar of incense, which was where the prayers were going up to God. We'll spend some time there in coming weeks. And the last place we've heard of it is the Holy of Holies. This is where the deepest, truest intimacy between God and his people occurred. It's where humility meets boldness. It's this weird tension of God says to come before him with boldness, but my gosh, if you're not ready, you drop dead, right? Like there's this invitation to come into his presence. It's where he dwells, and it's where he invites the high priest to come in. Over the next couple weeks, we're gonna peek into these places. But today, I want to sit on the court of the Gentiles for a moment. Because this is where most of our experiences with church, this is where we've done it. It's the superficial, the surface level relationships. The where we come in and we say, hey, how are you doing? Shake your hand. And that's a good enough answer, right? Good. I'm good. Good. How are you? Fine. And then that's it. And that's actually not a bad thing. Like, that's God ordained. That is an act of mercy. We need that. Common courtesy is the expectation, right? It's like, you have to be decent here. The rules are in play. We know what the social rules are. You gotta behave in order to hang out in the court of the Gentiles. That's where customary kindness and introductions to people, that's where that gets made. Outsiders frequently walk into a church and they're checking it out. They don't want to get too close yet because we need some safety. We need some distance. And in the original temple, that was where anyone could go hang out. Your good behavior would be rewarded with an offer to go further in. Maybe a deeper trust. We need that protection. We need that help to guard us. Come on, be honest. Most of us have plenty of anxiety and stress and worries and pain and frustration and relational issues. We don't need more of that, do we? Anyone want to sign up for seconds at the next potluck of that? No, it's a protective thing that God's given us. You can stay there as long as you behave. Just don't bring any trouble. Don't bring your garbage in here, right? We know the rules. We'll tolerate you as long as you aren't stirring up the pot. How many of you guys have ever done the family dinner at a holiday where it's like all the family? Some of them you're really close to, and some of them you're like, I don't like them. I don't even know them. I don't like them. You know the rules, right? You don't talk two things at the dinner table. You don't talk politics, and you don't talk religion. Yeah, you know the rules. Stay clear, in other words, from the things you really care about. Stay away from the things that cause you deep grief or you really, really are burdened by. This is what the proverb writer Solomon tells us in Proverbs 4:23. Guard your heart above all else, for it determines the course of your life. This is actually a good thing. At the temple, anybody could go hang out there. Even outsiders, even if you didn't believe, you could go hang out there. But sadly, I would say 99% of the churches I've ever seen, that's all that happens at the church gathering. Too many churches are content to park the car right there and never invite somebody a chance to go in deeper. That's not good. You're not close to God right there. You're not close to other people right there. But I need to feel safe. I prefer the safety of I don't need to know your junk because I hate the potential of getting messy. I've been burned before. Anybody else? You let somebody in, they kick you in the butt. I don't know about you. When we go to a function, I'm driving my own car. I don't need to ride with y'all. Because then I can't leave when I'm ready to. I go to a restaurant, I go to a place, I'm sitting by the aisle because I need permission to pull the chute as soon as it looks like the plane's going down. We're ready to bolt at the first hint of trouble. We're convinced that no one's gonna love us. No one can tolerate my junk. If they knew what I struggled with, No way. And we believe the lie. We believe the lie that the enemy says, in order to fit in, I got to keep my junk in the closet. No one will let me be the real me here. The enemy intends to keep every single one of us in that outer place forever. Looking in, wishing we could take a step, but too scared and too stuck to ever do it. If you would dare to dream of taking a step closer to God, of connecting to his people, that's war. Jesus' incarnation on the planet Earth, when he came down, that was an aggressive invasion, right? The enemy is he learned that lesson the hard way. He's making sure none of us ever take that step. And if you do, oh yeah, you got a bullseye on your face now. You will be singled out and targeted. But my goodness, I am grateful for Jesus' words in John 16. Jesus says, I've told you all this so that you may have peace in me. Here on earth, you'll have many trials and sorrows, but take heart because I've overcome the world. Friends, what would happen today if we actually decided to roll the dice, to play and take one step to go deeper in with God? What would happen if you said, okay, I'm sick of staying out here and not feeling anything, I'm going in? What would happen if you did that with somebody, a person? I can't promise you it won't be scary and it won't be tough, but I can share, I've shared a few weeks recently, he's done that in me recently. This year, I told you, I bumped into a pastor friend who's always been a buddy. He was a coworker at one time. We've been friendly. We served together, man. Our kids, we're good. But I bumped into him at the grocery store, and he's like, hey, man, how's it going? I'm good. And I returned the favor. How are you? And he goes, oh, that's not 30 seconds. Let's go get lunch. And we sit down at lunch, and he says, I want to invite you to go deeper. And I'm put dead deer in the headlights in that moment. I can play it safe. I can go, oh, nah, bro, I'm good. I got plenty. But I felt a tug of the soul. I felt the push of the Spirit. No, you can't stay in that outer court forever. Go deeper. Take that step. So I did. I'm like, okay, let's get together. And he said, BJ, I want to be a pastor for pastors. I want to invite you to be real with somebody. I want you to be open and put it all on the table. And that first time we sat down, he started with a question that made me almost pee my pants. Where are you at right now? Well, that's easy. I'm sitting in your living room. Where do you feel shame? What are you grieving right now? What are your deepest longings? And I literally felt the tension in my neck and shoulders, felt my hair stand up, felt my knees start to knock, my gut twist. I have to make a choice. Do I take that step or do I keep it cursory and casual and be like, nah, I'm good. Maybe next time. And that fear, that anxiousness is what holds us back. I mean, let's be honest. Look at your neighbor. If they knew the real you, that would cause a stink, right? We can't stir the pot. We're going to be forced to run for cover if it gets uncomfortable. That fight or flight reflex, that's a real thing. That's not casual. That's not a nothing. People are going to run in terror if they learn how messed up I am. They can't take that. And so we come to church. And we resolve, I'm going to just keep the mask on today. My costume that I've dressed up in today, I got complimented because I'm wearing pants. My costume looks nice. The charade is acceptable because it's comfortable. It's familiar. Guys, I believe God is inviting you right now in your seat. The real you, the broken you, the sinful you, the spiteful you, the selfish, rebellious, messed up person that you are, he's inviting you in. Man, the Japanese art kintsugi, that is the craziest thing on planet Earth to me, where artisans take a smashed, broken mess and they repair it. They use gold in the bonding and they make it more valuable than it ever was before. That's what God is offering to do for you, to transform you, not your neighbor, to transform you into a living, breathing, walking, talking temple. Hallelujah. That literally shows the whole world around you what happens if you live in an authentic and intimate connection with God, and when you let that go to the people near you, what that looks like. That is insane. So what should we do? You're sitting here thinking, man, that sounds nice. I wish I could do that. As I want to invite you to accept the invitation. You know it. Jesus has been reaching out to you for a long time. But we have to accept the invitation and decide, I am going to take a step. For some of us, that deliberate, actual, intentional step might mean today in your seat, standing up and coming up and praying and committing and surrendering. I know this. I took a step that was terrifying. A few years ago, wounded my daughter. We had that courteous, we won't talk about it. Shh. We just let it sit. And it wasn't bad, it just wasn't close. And God invited me. You gotta repair that, you gotta address that, you gotta take a step. And I went to her and I'm like, hey, I suck, I know it, I'm sorry. And you know what she did? She didn't run and scream. She said, I love you. What if you offered intimacy today to somebody that you trust? What if you actually said, okay, I'm done playing. I can't stay out here forever. Ask God right now where you're sitting. Would you reveal, would you illuminate, would you show me somebody that I can take that step with? I know it's scary, you've been burned, but I know he wants that for you. Wrestle with that question today, friends. Who are you right now? Where are you at? What do you really want? What are you looking for? What do you need? What are you missing? You wrestle with those questions. I believe God is going to give you a next step. You have to commit, though, guys. It's not a feeling. It's not just a, dang, that was emotional. BJ teared up, so I guess I have to. You can't wait for somebody else to reach to you. Because God's already been doing that. Our whole lives he's been reaching. Now he's inviting us to go deeper in. I want to challenge you. Take that step today. Would you guys pray? Heavenly Father, we come today and we ask that you would please show us the face, show us the person, show us the step that we can take to draw closer to you, to draw closer to your people. Father, we're so grateful that you're patient. No matter how many times I step in and then run back out, you're faithful and you never give up. So God, help me, help us, help this church family move in today. We thank you, we love you, and we ask for the courage, for the conviction to follow you with all of our heart, our soul, our mind, and our strength. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Would you guys stand? We're going to invite you to sing. If you want to come and pray, I'd love to pray with you. We have prayer partners who would also do that today. Come and respond.
In Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my life, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, heard through the earthless drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, what fears and still when striving cease. My comforter, my all in of God in helpless pain. This gift of love and righteousness scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied for every sin. Thank you.
the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no schemes of men can ever pluck me from his hand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of Christ I stand till he returns or calls me home. Here in the power of
pray that the love, peace, and grace of the Father goes with us today. May his presence dwell as we go out. God bless you guys. Have a great day.
That once was crowned with thorns is crowned with glory now. The Savior knelt to wash our feet. Now at his feet we bow. The one who shines for all to see. You're